Well, welcome. Thank you so much for coming. We have standing room only, but we wanted to have the opportunity for as many of you as possible to come hear the message today. This is, I'm Roger Ream, president of the Fund for American Studies. This is the Capitol Hill Lecture Series for interns and staff on the Hill that we run every summer. This is our sixth summer doing this, thanks to great generous funding from Steve and Nancy Einhorn, supporters of ours in Milwaukee, Wisconsin. My only commercial for the Fund for American Studies is to ask you to pick up a brochure on your way out if you're interested in extending your internship stay in Washington. We have fall and spring semester programs here as well as summer. So if you want to stay through the fall, intern, it's a great program. Academic credit is offered to all who participate, and we find great internships that match your career interests. So if you want to do this again, please pick up our brochure. Our next lecture in this series will be next Thursday in the Dirksen Building with Judge Andrew Napolitano. So please be sure to put that in your calendar and attend that. It's my pleasure to introduce our speaker today and our partner in this lecture program, Senator Rand Paul of Kentucky. I've known Dr. Paul since we were both young. I got older, he stayed young, and he's gone on to great things in his career. After graduating from Duke Medical School, he opened an ophthalmology practice in Bowling Green, Kentucky, which he ran for 18 years. Incredibly successful practice, restoring people's vision, not only in Kentucky, but around the world. Now he volunteers his time going on mission trips to places like Haiti and Guatemala to do cataract surgery, all pro bono, help people with eye problems. He does that in Kentucky as well. While in Congress, he was elected in 2010. He took very seriously the oath he took in January of 2011 to uphold the Constitution. He's been fighting to protect the liberties of the American people ever since. He serves on the Foreign Affairs Committee, the Homeland Security Committee, several other committees in Congress. He's been a leading advocate for economic, civil, and political liberties of the American people. So please join me in welcoming Senator Rand Paul.
Somebody had to pay for it. And so it is great that philanthropists want to give back to the Fund for American Studies. And welcome to all of you. Now, it's a lot of pressure to give a speech because there's a lot of you here, but there's not going to be a speech you at least get for lunch. All right? So you will get something out of this. But I think we live in extraordinary times. One of the big things that's in the news right now is that there are four countries that border on famine: Somalia, Sudan, Nigeria, and Yemen. And so when you hear and see the horrific pictures and you hear of famine, you think, well, what can we do? You know, we're a rich country, so we give back in many ways. You'll see, pictures like what I'm getting ready to show you, you'll see these. And Americans, because we are so rich and we are generous, we give a lot of money. We give a lot of food. But the question is the answer food for famine? What is the cause of famine? You know, it is sometimes natural disaster. It is sometimes climate. They're in inhospitable places where people live on the margins often. But really, if we look hard at famine, we often see one other common thing. And what's the common thread between Yemen, Sudan, Somalia, and Nigeria? It's war. Bad government and war. And so if we don't understand that, we're never going to fix the problem. There's a writer from New Mexico named Sharman Russell. And she puts it this way. She says that when we look at famine, we tend to focus on the biologic. We tend to focus on the mother and the child. And because of that, it obscures the problem, the political and economic problems that lead to famine. And we end up with this belief that food is the answer. And you say, well, that sounds terrible. Food is the answer. Well, food is sort of part of the short-term answer, but it really isn't the answer. The answer is somehow you have to have an absence of war. It's probably the most important thing you have to have. But to have an absence of war and for your country to thrive, you have to have a couple of other things. We keep asking ourselves, why does X country not thrive? Why is this country not getting ahead? Absence of war is one, but really you have to have a government that has the rule of law for property, and you have to have the freedom of the marketplace. You have to have these things. These things are essential. And you say, nah, we'll be fine with socialism. Socialism's great. We'll just have socialism. Look at the two examples we have of socialism for countries with great wealth, and because of bad government, they're virtually living at the level of starvation. Nigeria and Venezuela. Venezuela in particular, because you have a government that proudly calls themselves socialist. The average Venezuelan's lost 20 pounds. Now, it could be they went from the first world, but we all weigh 20 pounds too much down, but I think it's worse than that. Losing 20 pounds without trying from a lack of food is a problem. This is a country with vast resources and vast oil deposits, and because of their economic system, they're in chaos, bordering on famine. Now, you might argue, well, Nigeria is not socialism. It's sort of dictatorship sometimes, or military juntas run the country often. But they have something in common with socialism. The oil is all owned by nobody. It's owned by the government, but individuals don't own any of it. If it's on your land, they take your land. If you look at property rights in Nigeria, you don't really see, you do see some private property, but you also see a rising tide of acquisition of property by the government, forced acquisition by the government. And so I think in both cases, and even in Nigeria, you might say, oh, no, it's corruption in Nigeria is the problem. However, when you have centralized government, when you have the power centralized instead of dispersed, you get one corrupt person at the top, you get corruption everywhere. If you have federalism or you have disbursement of it, one, you're closer to your city councilman. If they steal from you, you're maybe more likely to catch them, and the problem's less widespread because your city councilman's only in charge, and your mayor's only in charge of a city. We have cities that have had corruption for a long time. It's like Chicago. But the thing is that you want power to be dispersed. You don't want all the power to be centralized, because if you do get someone corrupt, or even if you get someone who makes a bad decision, one reason why you don't want one person in charge of your education is because if one person makes a bad decision and in charge of all of the education, the whole country suffers. So if you disperse the power, where decision-making is made more at a local level, mistakes affect less people, good decisions affect less people, but you have a better fighting chance for finding out what works in government. Which gets us to the famine in Yemen. So we have a famine in Yemen, and we have a war in Yemen. You need to realize, as the young people who fight the wars, that we're part of it. It's never in the news. The news is consumed with the political theater of Comey and Russia, and Sessions will be testifying today. Now, I don't discount that Russia probably had something to do with our elections, but I'm actually more concerned with the 17 million people that are living on the edge of starvation in Yemen. 17 million people. It's already one of the poorest countries. Why don't they have any food? There's a Saudi blockade of Yemen. And the food can't get through. Who's part of the blockade? Kind of the United States. We've got ships prowling everywhere, stopping supposedly arms from coming in, but it's also blocking food from coming in. They already, to begin with, imported 90% of the food. And people say, well, how bad is it? Observers on the ground say that it's as bad as Syria. You've all seen the horrific pictures in Syria. Hundreds of thousands of people, if not millions, displaced in Syria. Starvation, bad water, bad health, everything. Random death, indiscriminate death on both sides of the war. Same thing's going on in Yemen. Just as bad. People are saying it's just as bad. Other people are saying, one refugee group said this. They said that we have an impending famine that will be of biblical proportions. That sounds pretty bad. And that's what's going on there. And so we have before us a decision. And I forced that decision. They're not having this vote today willingly. I'm forcing them to vote on whether we should sell arms to Saudi Arabia. Because of a 1976 law that says that one senator can demand a vote. So I volunteered. I'm working with Senator Murphy, so it's bipartisan. We've got Republican and Democrat. In fact, most of the votes with us today will be Democrat. There'll be a few Republicans, three or four. If we get three or four, and most Democrats, we might actually win. Will we actually win the battle then? No, because we can only force the vote in the Senate. In the House, the leadership has a choice of bringing it up or not. And because the leadership is for more arms, we won't bring it up. But I thought what I'd mention today is a couple things, and we'll open it for discussion. First, let's have a poll. I think it's good to have a poll in the audience first to see where we are. So raise your hand if you're for selling arms, for the deal that was signed, that President Trump signed to sell arms to Saudi Arabia. Raise your hand. Don't be bashful. We can get more than that. We're certainly able to get more than that. There's a few more. All right, raise your hand if you're against the arms. All right, we have stacked the crowd. I got an eight. Now, the speech really isn't so much for those who agree with me. It's also for those who are either undecided or disagree. And we'll have a discussion. You can ask me any question you want. Well, maybe any question. Let's just mostly have about this. But here's the point. There's a couple of points about selling weapons to Saudi Arabia. One of them is, are they an ally that is dependable in not giving arms to terrorists? Well, I'll give you a couple of examples of how they may not be. Bob Graham was a Democrat senator up here, was head of the Intel Committee, and he wrote a book called Intelligence Matters. He's been a big proponent of releasing the 28 pages. I've read the 28 pages. You can read them now. They're online. It took about 15 years to get them online. In these documents, what you find out is every trail seems to be pointing and intersecting with somebody from Saudi Arabia. 15 of the 19 hijackers were from Saudi Arabia. No small coincidence. But if you follow the trails, like to the two of the hijackers in San Diego, the guy that got him in the apartment worked for the Saudi government. His pay went up from like $20,000 a month to $40,000 a month once the two people arrived. It kind of looks as if he was taking care of them. There were calls to embassies. There's a lot of circumstantial evidence. But enough to be worried. Our worst terrorist attack somehow may have had a link to Saudi Arabia. You say, oh, no, nobody believes that. Well, Congress voted about 6 months ago nearly unanimously to let American citizens sue the Saudi Arabian government. We had to have a special law to make it illegal to do that because it's very unusual to sue a foreign government. We did it because the 9/11 victims and their families have asked for years to be able to get some recompense for this terrible tragedy. And I think we ought to know the truth if somebody attacked us. Others will say, and most of the Republicans on this will say in the audience today, or say on the front center floor, they will say we need to do this because Saudi Arabia helps in the war on terror, that they actually give us some information. And I think they probably do. I think for every time they help us, they probably hurt us three times, but they do help us some. But 9/11, big question, was not with Saudi Arabia involved. But even more recently, the war in Syria. One of Hillary Clinton's emails that she sent to John Podesta, which you kind of feel is genuine because it was revealed illegally through WikiLeaks, and so you get her talking frankly with John Podesta, and she says, we need to put pressure on Saudi Arabia and Qatar because they're giving financial and logistical help to ISIL. So we're now not talking about something 15 years ago, we're talking about now in Syria, in that war, Saudi Arabia and Qatar giving financial help to the bad people, the people who are over there trying to defeat. So that worries me some. We're going to be giving weapons to them. They say, oh, no, it's different. But it's not only they're kind of like a frenemy. They're part friend, part enemy, part adversary, part friend. But I worry not only about where the weapons are going, whether they're going to be doing something good. They don't worry about Yemen. There's a blockade in Yemen. There's a bombing campaign that seems to be indiscriminate bombing. Everybody's complained, from the UN to multiple countries have complained about civilians dying. I'll give you one of the worst instances of the Saudi bombing campaign. They bombed a funeral procession. There was 125 people killed in the funeral procession and 500 wounded. And we sometimes ask ourselves, who are these people? Why are they burning the American flag? Why do they hate Saudi Arabia? Well, maybe they're related to one of those people that were killed. Maybe they're one of the wounded. Maybe they're related to them. You see, this stuff transmits forever. We tend to be a very, very, a culture with a very, very short memory. They have a really long memory over there. They have a lot of time to think about their history, and they do. So you've heard of the Battle of Karbala. It's like 680 AD. They're still pissed off about it, all right? We can't remember our history from a decade ago. We're forgetting Vietnam. They're still pissed off about Karbala, 680 AD, grandson of Muhammad is defeated by another caliph. But anyway, they know their history. There was a comment the other day that I thought was really good. I think it was from an Afghan to one of our troops. And he said, you know what? You have all the watches, but we have the time. And there's some truth to that. They know eventually we'll leave. If you see this, there's a movie recently called The War Machine. And it was written by Michael Hastings, who wrote that famous Rolling Stone author, where the sort of was part of General McChrystal getting drummed out. And this movie kind of depicts, you know, General McChrystal and our, they go and they liberate a village in Helmand Province. And it's this is sort of the tragedy of war. My war is just this sort of fog, and it's like, we should fight when we have to. When we have to defend ourselves. But getting involved in all these messy wars, they're really, really messy and hard to determine who are the good guys and who are the bad guys. So they go into Helmand Province, and somebody's shooting at them, and you look, and your buddy is shot in the head and is dead there, and everybody's like, you know, there's a big, huge response. They launch mortars on a building, and the bad guys get away, but the family that was sort of being forced to host the bad people, their kids are killed. And so the villagers are there, and the general says, we've brought you liberty, and we're going to take care of you, we'll bring security, and the people are very, in the movie, are very passive, and they're like, please leave. And they say, we brought you liberty, and we've liberated you, and we're going to create a great country for you here. And he says, the sooner you leave, the better. You will eventually leave. The sooner you leave, the better, the less repercussions there will be for being in our village from the Taliban. And the thing is, 15 years later, we've been training. Now people in our government are talking about another surge in Afghanistan. So we have to decide when we're going to go to war. We have to have a real debate about it. We're involved in the Yemen war. We're partly responsible for what Saudi Arabia is doing. We not only are supplying them the bombs, we're refueling their planes, and we're actually helping them with targets. I presume we didn't help target the funeral, but we are supposedly helping them with targets. So there's a question of whether or not they are encouraging terrorism. There's also the question of teaching. If you say to me, well, gosh, Iran's really bad, and who's worse, Iran or Saudi Arabia? Well, Iran is sort of a regional player for the most part. They are very involved, and they're trying to dominate the region the same way Saudi Arabia is. But if you talk about who teaches hatred of America, who teaches hatred of the Judeo-Christian world, it's Saudi Arabia and all of their schools. In our country, they're, you know, Indonesia, they're polluting the world with this anger. And they do both. They help us on one page, and then they give money to all this anger. They were funders of bin Laden for dozens of years. In fact, something people say he was radicalized when they quit funding him. But they funded him for a long time. So you have funding, inconsistent behavior. But the other thing we have, and this is where this intersects with Iran, is that there's an arms race going on. So we're going to have a vote on new sanctions on Iran. And I have voted for sanctions in the past, but I'm not going to vote for new sanctions. Because one, we have an agreement with them now, and they're adhering to it. They're adhering to the nuclear agreement. People say, well, the ballistic missiles, they're still developing ballistic missiles. And I was like, well, instead of sanctions from one country, which won't work, maybe what we should do is talk about the Saudi arms, and maybe we should say we're going to withhold Saudi arms from Saudi Arabia until they come to the table with Iran. We have a regional agreement on ballistic missiles. I mean, I don't know if we can actually make it happen, but that should be our goal. That would be the ultimate goal. Saudis and the Gulf Sheikhdoms sign an agreement with Iran to have a ballistic missile weapons ban, or a ban on continuing to increase the numbers of ballistic missiles. But instead, we're not really thinking through what happens. So also, what is the reaction? So I told one of the senators the other day, you know, I was doing this, and his smart alecky response when I said that, you know, there'll be a reaction for Iran. Iran will have more incentive to develop weapons when we give them to Saudi Arabia. His reaction was, oh, so it's our fault. As if I'm saying I'm blaming it on us. No, I'm not blaming it on us. I'm just saying that if you look at foreign policy, you have to care what your opponent thinks. So we were in a committee hearing the other day, and one of the Republican senators piped up and said, I don't care what Tehran thinks. I don't care what Iran thinks. And it's like, that's the purpose of sanctions, is you do care what they think, and through sanctions you're trying to get them to change their behavior. So you do care what they think, because what they think is what they do. It doesn't mean you condone what they think. It doesn't mean you agree with what they think. But if we have people involved creating our foreign policy that don't care what our opponents think, that's not understanding anything about diplomacy. You have to care. You don't have to agree. But if you want to change someone's behavior, you have to care about what they think. You have to understand what they care about. So when Iran develops ballistic missiles, what are their reasons? I can't tell you all of them. I'm not Iran. I don't know the leaders. I would guess some of it's a belligerence and thumbing us in the eye. But I think at least a significant part of it is directed against the Saudi and the Gulf Sheikhdoms. And so as they develop weapons, Iran wants to develop. Who has more? You hear everything, we've got to do something about Iran, we've got to do something about Iran. The weapons and the numbers are amazing. The Gulf Sheikhdoms spend 8 times more than Iran does. If you look at the spending now, Saudi Arabia is the third biggest in the world. It's us. And when you're told we don't spend enough, we spend more than about the next 8 countries combined. So we just dominate everybody in what we spend. So when you're told that it's hollowed out and we've got to increase our military spending by 16% or 10% or whatever the number is, it's not true. We have the largest, most mighty military in the world, and it's just not true that it's hollowed out or lack of money. Now, we may be overextended because our mission's too big, and we might have 10 too many wars that we're involved with, but it's not that we necessarily don't have enough money. So the balance is actually, when you look at the balance of power in the arms race, it's all on the Gulf side. It's on the Saudi side. And so Iran did get some money. You know, we signed the nuclear agreement, and they got their money back. They got about $100 billion. What are they doing with it? Probably quite a bit of it they're plowing into their ballistic missile system. So that's their reaction to the Saudis. Now our reaction is to give the Saudis more money. It's an arms race. What about Israel? Israel is our ally over there, and a dependable ally. But Israel, I met with Netanyahu a couple years ago, and his response was, for every dollar they spend, we'll spend two. So if everybody reacts to someone else, and you can be on one of those 3, 4, or 5 different sides in the Middle East, but you have to at least acknowledge there's a reaction for a reaction. If none of this convinces you, it'd say, oh, but we just need to play real politic, and the Saudis are better than the Iranians, and we're going to side with the Saudis. You ought to know a little bit about what happens in Saudi Arabia, and then we're going to have another poll. So in Saudi Arabia, what are some of the things that can happen to you? Well, there was a girl of Qatif. She was 19 years old, and she was raped by 7 men. Now, the men were punished, that's good, but so was the woman, because it was her fault that she was raped, according to their law. She was given 6 months in prison and sentenced to 200 lashes. So she's to be beaten, whipped, and put in prison for being raped. Her crime was being with a man who she was not married to. That's who we're giving weapons to. Shouldn't you think, well, gosh, I'm not willing to invade Saudi Arabia to tell them what to do. They can do what they want to do. If they want to have that civilization, that's fine. But it doesn't mean I have to support them. It doesn't mean I have to give them money. So there's a difference between saying, we're going to modulate your values by invading you, and saying, you know what, we're going to withhold something that belongs to the American people, and that is our armaments, until you act a little better, according to what we think. And that's one way we can sort of spread our values without saying we're going to conquer people and spread them. We're just not going to give you arms if you don't pay. So anyway, her sentence was finally reduced because we did sort of probably make some of that rumbling about not giving as many arms, and we did complain. But we need to. We can't just ignore and shove it under the carpet and say, oh, we're just not going to do anything about it. There was another young man in Saudi Arabia. His name is Ali Al-Nimr. He's still in jail. He's on death row, and his sentence will be beheading and crucifixion. His crime is that he went to a protest during the Arab Spring. As the Arab Spring was rising, his father, his uncle, was a guy named Nimr al-Nimr, and he was a sheikh, but he was a Shia sheikh, so is Ali al-Nimr. They're about 10% of Saudi Arabia. So he goes to a protest during the Arab Spring, and his uncle is caught, beheaded, and so then they capture him at a protest, and now he's been in jail for 3 or 4 years. And it's not a great place, according to the reports of the family. But the human rights like these abuses, they go on and on. Rafe Badawi is a blogger. He's in prison for 10 years for, let's just say, unorthodox. They call him an atheist. He says he's not an atheist. But anyway, he has unorthodox views that he types. Anybody here have an unorthodox view they put online? You know, that's not a sign of a free society. He's got 10 years in prison and 1,000 lashes. I think he's had 100 of them, public lashes. And I think the reason they don't give them all at one time is you die from 1,000 lashes at one time. It's not a pleasant sight. But we should talk about these human rights abuses. Do you know who's going to be in charge of the Human Rights Committee in the UN next year? Saudi Arabia. We have to speak out about these problems. And I'm not saying we invade other countries to tell them they're misbehaving. We certainly shouldn't reward them with weapons. And we certainly should be aware of what happens to people. This issue has been a good issue, I think, because it's bringing Republican and Democrat together. But there's a quote by William Wilberforce, and I'll end with this that I like. He says, having heard all this, he's talking about slavery. He says, having heard all this, you can look the other way. Having heard all this, you can look the other way and say, you know, but you cannot say, I didn't know. So having heard all this, you can look the other way but you can never say again that you didn't know. It's the same thing with things like this. We need to think through. So having heard what you have heard of the famine in Yemen and the disaster that's going on there, we shouldn't look away. We should participate. We should try to say, let's send a message to the Saudis. The bill today of the $300 billion is for $500 million. There's a certain symbolism. It's not the whole thing. But wouldn't it be great just to send them a message? They'll probably get the weapons anyway because it's never going to come up in the House and the president's going to veto it. But I do hope that instead of looking the other way and not looking at an unpleasant picture, this young man died, not looking away, that we say it is important. Values do mean something, and that we shouldn't be offering our weapons and our support to a country with these horrible abuses. And I hope you'll be part of the next generation that doesn't look away. Thank you.